The energy of infinite intelligence is in our chapel. Let us all rejoice. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad that you are here on this beautiful day. Seems like the rest of us decided to stay home. but as we always say, the people that are supposed to be here are here. So we're glad to see you all. I'm Reverend Cheryl Francis, and our opening song is going to be How Great Is Our God. So please rise as you're able and remain standing for the prayer of invocation and the Lord's Prayer. Please join me in an attitude of prayer. Father, Mother God, we are thankful together within these walls once more to worship in spirit and in truth. We affirm infinite love and creative energy in all things and all people. We pray for each other and the families we represent, both seen and unseen. We pray for all those names which have been placed in the prayer list, for those in hospitals and nursing homes, the hospice, those who are alone, those who are without home and in the streets, and have no one to pray for them. We ask that all souls receive love and healing and spiritual unity, and that all people should desire peace on earth. All this we affirm by praying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from error. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Now is the time when we recite the principles of our religion together, as seen on the screen.
We believe in God as infinite intelligence. We believe that the phenomena of nature, physical and spiritual, are the expression of infinite intelligence. We affirm that a correct understanding of such expression and living in accordance therewith constitute true religion. We believe in personal responsibility and that we create our own happiness or unhappiness as we live in harmony or discord with natural, physical, and spiritual laws. We affirm that the existence and the personal identity of the individual continues after leaving the physical world. We affirm that communication with spirit is a natural experience and is demonstrated through mediumship. We affirm that examples of prophecy and healing found in the Bible and other sacred texts are divine attributes found in all people. We believe that the highest morality is contained in the Golden Rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. We affirm that the doorway to reformation is always open to any soul here or hereafter.
Our meditation music for today is The Change in Me. So just close your eyes and relax in that silent place and take in the words and the music to help you get ready for the guided meditation, which will follow.
Your spirit is a gentle set me free. Your spirit is a wrecking ball, tearing through my rebel walls. And one by one I watch them fall, till you are all I see.
Travel to that silent place within where your heart and soul resides. See or sense that you are in a room, and the room has a door. On the other side of that door, there is an energy waiting to be let in, an energy that wants to set you free from the restrictions of all the thoughts that hold you in one place. Breathe. It is a gentle energy. It feels light, like the movements of a butterfly's wings. And you want to open that door, but your fear of change pulls you one way, and your desire to be closer to your Creator pulls you another way. And as you sit there, you must decide if you are willing to give up your past for the future. Breathe. If you open that door, the energy will rush in and surround you, pulling out all the negative thoughts and destroying all the negativity in you. The hurtful past, which influences all your actions and thoughts, are destroyed one by one, and you can watch them fall and feel the change in you. You can feel that energy is the life force in you, in the air you breathe, the cause of the change in you. The energy will whisper to your heart, banishing deafening lies that cause fear within you. Your heart will be full of energy, and it will speak and assure you there is no reason for fear. Breathe. Now we are going to open that door together, very slowly. And as we open it, welcome the energy of infinite intelligence. Allow the walls of the past to fall so that you may see the future. And they fall, and there are clouds of thick dust. And when the dust floats away, you see a bright light in front of you, calling you into the depths of tomorrow, daring you to take a step to allow that glorious energy to lead you into the unknown. Breathe. You can now feel the new life in you. You can feel it in the air you breathe. You can sense a change caused by this energy. Your spirit rises and becomes like a holy flame, eagerly burning away the debris of the old way. And you declare, I am ready. I am ready to travel the new path. I am ready to let go of the old way so that all that is left in me is the energy of infinite intelligence. Breathe. You will hear, I will be your constant friend. I will be with you for all eternity. You will never feel alone again because I am the change in you. Breathe. Now bring yourself back to the chapel and adjust your eyes as we turn up the lights. Our scripture today is from 1 Timothy 1:15. The goal of our instruction is love, from a pure heart and a good conscience and sincere faith. Spirit bless the reading of the scripture. As you can guess, we're going to talk about change. The last time, 3 weeks ago, when I gave a lecture, it was about leaving behind sense consciousness, as the Israelites left Egypt, which was sense consciousness, and their journey across the Red Sea, where the higher vibrations of Moses and the people made the waters part. And when they reached the other side, it drowned all the bad desires of sense consciousness. And then they went into the wilderness. So in the wilderness, we lost something, but we haven't gained anything yet. We're just kind of wandering around. We have left the sense consciousness, and we now represent illuminated thoughts and consciousness, which are undergoing spiritual discipline, which means we're trying to put together in our mind what it is to be spiritual. We've been in sense consciousness, the Israelites, for 400 years. So what is it? What does it mean to be spiritual? What we have in us, that sense of right and wrong, is the total of our religious thoughts. In the beginning of our journey from sense consciousness to spiritual consciousness, from Egypt to the Promised Land, not all these religious thoughts are awake to spiritual truth. We have a will to follow the inner leading of divine law. We have a will to do what is right. We're just not really sure what it is. Divine law is spiritual thoughts that pertain to the real and enduring ideas upon which man and the universe are founded. We are still very far from a permanent spiritual level of activity. So as searchers of truth, we have left Egypt. We have a long way to go to reach that promised land. There is that interim period where we just wander. And you know, sometimes when you don't know what to do, your thoughts just kind of wander. You would be open to new lessons and new truths if they were presented to you. The Israelites wandered around for 40 years. And that 40 years was the last 40 years of Moses' life, and the most important one for him. Now, when we hear 40 years in the Bible, it doesn't actually mean 40 years. It is just a phrase that means it took the time that it took for this to be completed. They could have wandered for 20 years. They could have wandered for 150 years. We don't really know. But that phrase, 40 years, just kind of covers it. It says it took as long as it took. The experience of the Israelites in that wilderness are really kind of like what we have to go through. It's the ups and downs that we go through when we pass in our spiritual progress. You know, one day you're there, and the next minute something happens and you're not there, and you can't get it back. And you can't get it back for a long time. And then you get it back again. This is kind of what they went through. These people desired to the will of God, which we do. We want to be divine. We know we have divinity in us, and that's what we want to live. We're not in sense consciousness now. We're trying to bring forth a spiritual consciousness, but often we allow fear to present spiritual consciousness. It prevents it, and we fall back into old familiar ways. The Israelites found they had no water in the desert. Then they came upon an oasis. They were, oh, thank you, God, there's water, there's water. When they tried to drink it, it was bitter. Imagine their disappointment and frustration. Those are the same things that we face. You know, we try to emphasize spirituality in our life. And some of the things that we learn are really bitter. When we look at the truth of our life, some things are not pleasant. They're really bitter. We may be faced with some problems. We have no idea how to face in spiritual consciousness. You know, somebody pushed the wrong button, and our anger flares up, and we don't know how to handle that. We just don't know. Well, that's how the people felt when they tried to drink this bitter water. And they ran to Moses and they said, what did you bring us out of Egypt for? We're going to die of thirst in the desert. Well, Moses prayed, and God showed him a tree, and he cast it into the waters, and the waters were made sweet. The lesson for us is, we have to learn to sweeten bitter experiences. The water itself represents emotion. Sometimes what we go through or what we think about leaves us with a bitter emotion. We have to learn to sweeten that. But only God can tell us how to do that. We may not know. We may not have the resources to do that. And like Moses, we should ask that energy of infinite intelligence what element we should use, what we can do, what thought do we need to sweeten that emotion. And we will hear what to do, and it will always be something that we can accomplish. So you would think when they got the water, they would get it. They didn't. A few days later, there was no game to be had, and they ran out of food. And again, they're crying to Moses. You took us out of Egypt. We'll die of starvation out here. We were better off there. Do we do that? Of course we do. We try to move on, and then we think, this is too hard. There's too much here I don't know about. I don't think I can do this. And you go back. You fall back on your old habits, your old ways of doing things. You kind of lose faith. Well, Moses prayed, and the manna fell. There is always a divine provision for us. Always. We may not like it. I mean, I don't think manna was delicious. It was like a moisture-like thing. It was on top of whatever, the desert or whatever, and you kind of scooped it up and ate it. But that was the daily bread for the Israelites. It was physical food to sustain their physical selves. But it also represented that all that was required for one day was the faith, courage, and intelligence. And if we remember, all we need is for one day, to do something one day, to feel a certain way for one day. Because we live in the now, you'd be surprised what we can do. But when we function in human consciousness, we want to make sure there's enough. There's more than enough. Because we lack faith. We lack the faith that will give us a feeling of security. And people have to feel secure. We do. The worst thing people have to face is unknown. Something that they don't know what the outcome is going to be, or they don't know what's going to happen next. You have to have a lot of faith. You really do. That faith will give you the security that you need. And if we feed on spiritual manna, the divine qualities God has given him, we are content with what is sufficient for our needs and have faith that will be provided for day by day. Now, this manna couldn't be hoarded. You could only collect enough for one day. If you tried to keep it to the next day, it's spoiled. But there was always enough to satisfy daily hunger. And that's when you come to the realization that God is the great provider. And we thank that energy for that nourishment. We can receive both physical and spiritual nourishment without worrying about tomorrow. Great lesson, right? Do you think the Israelites learned their lesson?
No.
No, of course not. And we probably won't either the first couple of times, you know, that we try this out. It'll happen and we'll think, well, that would happen anyway or whatever. Later they were thirsty again and we go through the whole thing again. And this time God told Moses to hit a rock, and when they did, water gushed forth. And again they were shown, when they were in need, you have to go to God. You have to go to infinite intelligence. Joyce Myers had a great line that she used. So when you're in trouble, don't go to the phone, go to the throne. You know, don't go to your friends and complain and vent. Just sit down and ask God to help you. Your friends aren't going to help you. Not really. They can commiserate with you, but there's only so much they can do. Later on in their journey, they were attacked by enemies. We all have enemies to deal with. Our enemies are temptation and negative energy. It's aimed at us. You know, the gossip across the street that tells us we're no good or we're this or we're that. That's negative energy. That is our enemy. Not necessarily the people saying it, but the energy. It affects us. Moses was told to hold up his hand with the rod of God, and the Israelites would be victorious in this battle against their enemies. But he grew weary, and his hand dropped, and the enemy prevailed. So Aaron and Hur held up Moses' hands when he did not have the strength to do so. Sometimes we just grow tired of the challenges. We don't think we have the energy to keep our consciousness on a spiritual level. We've been beaten down. You know, basically, life has been too much. We have to ask others who know the truth to sustain us, to give us words of inspiration, to pray with us, to meditate with us. Just like Hur and Aaron held up the hands of Moses. Now we have a book in the back on the back table for people who need healing from physical illness. But our mental, emotional, and spiritual problems should be treated as well. So as you leave, if you have a friend who needs that kind of healing, write their name in that book. It is not just for physical healing. It's healing for all others who are suffering from all types of attack on their spiritual consciousness. These attacks will come from others or from inside as we doubt ourselves, as we doubt our ability and our level of understanding. How many times have you said, I would love to do that, but you never go and take a class, you never buy a book, you never do any, because you don't think you can do it. Most people find if they apply themselves to something, they can do it. The important thing is to figure out where to spend your energy at. Let us look after each other so none of you fail to receive the grace of God. In Hebrews 12:15, we should take care of each other. As metaphysicians, we should try to help others as much as we can, so that everybody can gain an understanding of the truth. For there is no grace or forgiveness of error without understanding. And that's why we come here, to classes and to listen to lectures, to try to get that understanding. Moses went up on the mountain. Anytime we're told somebody's going up on the mountain to receive divine law, it represents an exalted state of mind that you have to obtain before the inspiration of spirit can be received. So when people say they're at the top of the mountain, they don't actually mean the top of the mountain. Martin Luther King had a great speech about being on top of the mountain and being able to see into the future what was going to happen. Likewise, Moses went to the top of the mountain and received something that benefits all of us. But you can't stay on the mountaintop too long, because what happens to your lower consciousness?
It gets restless.
Yeah, it needs inspiration. It's going to seek something else for its truth. And that's what happened to these people. They made a golden calf, and they were worshiping it. And Aaron helped them. He represents the high priest of intellectual consciousness. Now, Moses stayed on the mountain for a while. We don't know how long, but a while. Maybe a couple weeks, maybe a month. And below, they could see smoke and hear noises, and they really thought that Moses was probably dead. So they wanted an idol that other people could see. They wanted what other people had. Aaron knew that that wasn't right, but he was afraid these people were going to mutiny, you know, take over and leave, not wait for Moses or something. So he made a golden calf for them to worship. He used earrings and other gold objects that people had. The ears represent obedience and receptivity of the mind, and giving earrings to Aaron means that the ideals were poured out upon intellect, and the intellect concentrated them in a state of consciousness on the natural plane, which is what the calf would be, which just means sometimes our thoughts are so concentrated, and that's all we're having. We're not having anything spiritual. It's just our mind. And it produces something on the natural plane that belongs to the natural plane. Meaning, if you want a washing machine long enough, you might be able to find yourself in a position to find a washing machine. And when that happens, you begin to worship the power of intellect. But that isn't spiritual. That is just a natural law that happens. This is idol worship and results in your whole body going back to that sense consciousness. When the intellect is the center of consciousness and all the jewels of the mind are poured within it, many golden calves or material mental structures are built up and worshiped. What do we worship? We worship our money, our house, our status. We worship what other people think of us. You know, we want to look a certain way, talk a certain way, be a certain way, so people will think well of us. There's a lot of things that we worship. Everybody has something different that's really important to them that comes from their upbringing and their circumstances in life. It's a widespread idea that through the power of money, that man is developed from ignorance to wisdom. When you hear people talking about how much good they could do if they had more money, this idea means they're worshiping that golden calf. They're making material things more important than spiritual. This idea has to be ground to powder and put away. And Moses ground the golden calf so that pure method can be put in action without all those false idols. God is your sufficiency. And if you're willing to obey his law, the way will open to you and your plans will work out in just the right way. Money will come to you as a servant instead of a master. People who are striving to get money to go into the Lord's work are worshiping the golden calf. You don't need money to be spiritual. They are doubting God's capacity, and their ideas along that line will be ground to powder. The great work of infinite intelligence has always been done by those who are willing to serve. As Jesus did, Paul, and the long line of reformers, the only capital was the Spirit of God. The Israelites represent the illuminated thoughts and consciousness, which are undergoing spiritual discipline. That's what we are doing when we're in the wilderness. We too maybe have gotten rid of sense consciousness, but we still have our intellect to deal with. The spiritual discipline teaches us to look for divine guidance for our daily needs as well as calamities, and to help each other seek the understanding that we need to follow natural law, and to use the facilities that we were born with to help us handle difficult situations and to move forward with the progression of our own soul. This is about progression of our soul. There is more than one thing we need to create spiritual discipline. We're wandering around, kind of guessing at what it is we have to do. We're missing the law. And our next sermon will explore what happened when Moses came down with the Ten Commandments. And we will go into depth to each of those to find out exactly what they mean. And so it is.